So when did you guys move?
That is so sweet.
Now, did you sell your other place?
Yes.
What's up here?
Thank you.
thank you much.
Upstairs?
Downstairs, first door.
Downstairs, first door.
Hey, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good.
You didn't hear me. I said, you want to borrow my glasses?
Well, I don't have my reading glasses, and I'm like...
That's why I wear mine. I don't have to wear them all the time, but I have just a little bit of distance, but it's changing. So you want to read it.
That's why I'm working on those. Okay. Have you been? So you officially sold your home to do
that?
Support us if you can. Next Sunday, there will be a congregational meeting following the service. I am told it will be relatively short. I don't know what it's about, but I'm told that it will be just quickly after church. The men's group is meeting this Tuesday at Scramblers in Canal Winchester at noon. Please join the men if you can. They had appeared to have a really good time last week, so I'm sure they will enjoy lunch again at Scramblers. There is a sign-up sheet in the back if you are interested in attending, so they have some idea to tell the restaurant how many seats they need. So if you're interested, please sign up. And then on October the 10th, there's the Golden Age Dinner. We know that some of you have not signed up as yet. I would certainly encourage you, if you're of that golden age, to sign up and join us. We'll be going to Der Dutchman in Plain City. The women of the church pick up the tab on that. So come and enjoy yourself. Bring husbands and wives, and we'll see you at Der Dutchman on the 10th. There's going to be the White Elephant Auction and Potluck. It will be Saturday, October the 15th at 6 o'clock. We're encouraging people to bring their covered dish or dessert. If you are so inclined, they also said you may bring something for the auction. Because remember, one man's junk is another man's treasure. So please come if you can and support that White Elephant sale. Again, there is a sign up in the back of the church if you're interested, so they know how much meat to buy. Okay. And then Buck stopped me and said, I know it's chilly in here. The AC is off. They will be firing up the boiler this week, so it will be warmer next week, with our fingers crossed. And they're working on it. So next week you should feel a little more warmth here in the building. And then I have a homework assignment for you. On your way out this morning, if you'll look above the double doors in the back, there is a new sign that is up. And next week I'll be asking you what that sign says. We do want to say a thank you to George Mingus for hanging it for us, because we needed a tall person, and as you know, he's tall, so he put the sign up there. So thank you, George. But your homework assignment, look above the door, and then let me know what the sign said. All right. With that, then, is there anyone else that has another announcement? I only pray you remember at least 5 out of 7. I do encourage you to take your bulletins home with you today. There's a lot of information in there, some of what I just told you, some that I just told you not in there. So, but take it home, read it at home, other than during the gospel, when pastor's making reference to the gospel lesson that's in the bulletin. So now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship by listening to the prayer. Thank you.
God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Therefore, we take a few moments of silence to confess our sin before the Lord. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
Hear this morning the good news of Jesus Christ that is for you. And the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you. And for his sake, God forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
This is my good friend. Now, you might think that I've lost my marbles.
let me just say, you don't need to think anymore. You can just know, okay? We love to have fun in church, and this is a good friend of mine. I thought I would bring Snuggles. He's been around for quite some time. In fact, when I went to college is when I first learned about Snuggles. He came, and I was moving from Ohio to Texas to study music, and I felt all alone. And one of the things that my mother and father bought me when I was in a new season of life was little Snuggles here, and he's been with me ever since. And over the years, I've really grown to understand that just like little Snuggles is with me, and he's been to a lot of different places with me, so too God is always with me. If you've ever seen my Monday motivational videos, I always end the same way. And I want to tell you why. Because this little stuffed animal, as silly as it is, reminds me that Jesus will never leave me, he'll never forsake me. He'll always be with me. Did you know that promise? That God is always with you. So when you're afraid, and like me, you went off to college, and you're not going to college, you're having fun. Soon, right? It'll be really quick. What's something that makes you guys afraid? Something that you're afraid of? The dark. Yeah, I just don't like the dark either. Don't tell anyone. Can you think of something that makes you afraid of? I'll let you think about it in a couple seconds. But when we're afraid, or maybe when we get sick, when we get the flu, this is flu season, Jesus can remind us that he's with us to bring us healing. When we have a test in school, we know that Jesus is with us to help us through the test. This little guy here, as silly as he is, he reminds me that God's always with me. And so that's why I always say, and don't forget, God is with you. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. So when you hear me say that, you'll know why I say that. So next time, who wants to bring in something that's special, either Nicholas or Anna? Let you guys choose. Now, don't do each other. But you guys get to choose somebody who wants to bring in something, and you can share it with us, and we'll see what's special to you. And this is how we get to know each other. So, Nicholas, Aaron, who wants to go next month? This will be next month. Nicholas, you have a big smile on your face. You want to do it next week? Or next month? Next month? You want to try that? Okay. I'll give this to you. Now, you can be thinking, now you have to be here next month, right? So, don't take the bag and not show up. So next month, we'll be waiting to see. And you can bring in anything you want that describes what's special to you. All right? So let's bow our heads, let's close our eyes, and let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for this wonderful time with these children. We thank you for the opportunity to get to know one another. We thank you for Snuggles. We thank you for the constant reminder that, Jesus, you are always with us. You will never leave us nor forsake us. So, Lord, may that be true for Nicholas and Aaron this week, that as they go about their week, they would know that you're with them. And they can pray to you at any time. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, guys. Thanks for coming up. I'll see you guys next month, all right? Good deal. Thank you.
Big couple announcement. Thanks to Big Uncle for those lovely moments on the altar. Beautiful, very beautiful. The first lesson on this, the 17th Sunday after Pentecost, is from the book of Habakkuk. The oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw, O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and you will not listen? Or cry to you violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack, and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous, therefore, judgment comes forth perverted. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll say the psalm responsibly. Do not be provoked by evildoers. Do not be jealous of those who do wrong.
For they shall soon wither like grass, and like the green grass fade away.
Put your trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and find safe pasture.
Take delight in the Lord, he shall give you your heart's desire.
Commit your way to the Lord. Put your trust in the Lord and see what God will do.
The Lord will make your vindication as clear as the light, and the justice of your case like the noonday sun.
Be still before the Lord and wait patiently. Do not be provoked by the one who prospers, the one who succeeds in evil schemes.
Refrain from anger, be courageous alone. Do not be provoked, it leads only to evil.
For evildoers shall be cut off, but those who hope in the Lord shall possess the land. The second reading is from the book of 2 Timothy. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and now I am sure lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you, through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and love, and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord, or of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God, who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher, and for this reason I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day what I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done.
This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. I preach this morning in the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Today is the 17th Sunday after Pentecost, and we continue in these weeks asking one another the challenging question, how are we growing in our relationship with God? How are we growing in our understanding of who God is and what God has done for us in Christ, that He is the propitiation of our sins, that He is the Savior of our sins, that He is the God who left heaven and who came to earth so that we may have everlasting life in Him. Now, last week, if you were here, we looked at a very interesting story. If you ever wanted to know what a conversation sounded like between two dead men, last week's sermon was for you. But we looked at, I know it sounds a little weird, we looked at how in this life, God gives us opportunity to repent of our sins. He gives us time and He gives us a window of opportunity to turn from our sins, to turn back to Jesus. But in the story last week, the rich man was being tormented in hell. The time was too late. And Lazarus, who was overlooked time and time again in this life, was receiving the comfort of the glorious heaven in his midst. Now today, we're going to look at another parable, and we're going to see what Jesus requires of us as we follow Jesus as his disciple. As we follow Jesus, Jesus gives us a command. He tells us not only to go and make disciples, but today we're going to look at the heart of what it means to follow Jesus as a disciple. Namely, to not only be forgiven of our sins in Christ, but to be a conduit through which God's love and grace and faithfulness and forgiveness flows to others. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn with me. Luke chapter 17, we begin at verse 5. The apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. The Lord replied, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Now, it's really important that we get the context of what's going on here. So let's look back at verse 1, because Jesus is answering the apostle's declaration and the request for more faith. But let's see what's going on. Jesus said, verse 1, occasions for stumbling are bound to come, but woe to anyone by whom they come. So in other words, there will be temptations in this life. There will be opportunities to sin. There will be time and time again occasions for stumbling, but woe to anyone by whom they come. Verse 2. It would be better for you if a millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea than for you to cause one of these little ones to stumble. Be on your guard. If another disciple sins, you must rebuke the offender. And if there is repentance, that word in the Greek is metanoia, if there is repentance, a change of mind, a change of heart, a change of behavior, then you must forgive. Right there, it doesn't give you an option. To follow Jesus is to not only be forgiven of your sins, but to be a disciple of Christ is to freely forgive others. And if the same person sins against you 7 times a day and turns back to you 7 times and says, I repent, I have a change of mind, a change of heart, which has therefore changed my behavior, you must forgive. Now Jesus gets right down to it. And out of this hard, high, most difficult standard, the apostles say in verse 5, increase our faith. Now, you got to love a petition like that, don't you? Lord, increase our faith. Give us more faith. This is impossible to do what you're asking us to do. Do you realize how impossible it is to forgive someone when they hurt you? The natural inclination, Jesus, of the flesh is to eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, to give back, to get rewarded for that which we are pleasingly working toward in this life. We want something, therefore we go and get something. If someone hurts us, we want to make sure that they get justice. Our cause, our justice. But this is the human faculty. This is not the way in which we operate in the kingdom of God. Jesus is teaching us that when we are sinners, we are forgiven of our sins as we come before Jesus. We're not just coming into church and every week go through the same ritual. No, we are reminding ourselves that if we're going to live as a disciple of Christ, if we are going to forgive others as Christ Jesus forgives us, we have to begin by saying, I am unworthy. Lord, I am unworthy, but I receive your forgiveness. The disciples are blown away. They say, Lord, increase our faith and listen to what Jesus said. He says, it's not the quantity of your faith, but rather the quality. Verse 6. The Lord replied, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, a very, very small seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Jesus is saying it's not the quantity of your faith. They're asking for more faith. Rightfully so. In other words, they're saying, okay, I can do this, but God, you're going to have to do this. Jesus is saying, no, no. It's not about the amount of faith that you have, because all you need is the mustard seed size. It's about the quality of faith. It's about the source from which that faith comes. It does not come from within, but rather it comes from without. It comes from heaven. And let me tell you something that can be a freeing word today for you. You cannot forgive others until you yourself have been forgiven. I don't know how many times I have spent with parishioners in my office and they say to me, Pastor, I can't forgive. And I say to them in return, yes, that is correct. You can't forgive that harm. You can't forgive that abuse. You can't forgive that person. But Christ Jesus, as he washes your sins, as he looks at your life as a beautiful child of God, redeemed and washed in the blood of Jesus, he requires you and commands you to forgive others. You can't forgive. You are absolutely right. Only Jesus can give you a grace to forgive others. So stop trying. Some of you are wearing yourselves out. Stop trying. Just say, Lord, I am unworthy. Touch my life today. May I know that I am unworthy so I can come before you and receive the grace, the forgiveness, the mercy of God in my life, so that then the conduit of my life may be one of love, peace, joy, not bitterness, not hostility, not revenge, but one of peace and love, forgiveness. You see, the whole point of Jesus' teaching today is simply this. You and I are unworthy. Verse 7. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, come here at once and take your place at the table? Would you not rather say to him, prepare supper for me, put on your apron and serve me while I eat and drink, and later you may eat and drink? Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you are ordered to do, say, we are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done. Now, Jesus, in this teaching, is not displaying the relationship or the kind of relationship with which he has with his apostles. He is not saying that he looks at his apostles, that God the Father in heaven looks down upon us on earth like a cosmic cop looking for us to do something dumb and stupid to punish us. No, that's not the heart of God. Jesus is not portrayed in this lesson as some thankless God. No, you're just doing your duty. That's your obligation. No, what he is saying is, in order to walk the life of discipleship, you have to begin with the premise, I am unworthy. I am unworthy. In the presence of God, we are unworthy, but God makes us worthy. When we come into this place to receive the word of the Lord, when we come to the table to receive the body of Christ, the blood of Jesus, we are unworthy. There's nothing that we can do to become worthy besides saying, God, I am unworthy. Make me worthy. You know, there was a time in my life, it was when I was in seminary. I did not go to seminary to become a pastor, but God's ways are always the best ways. And I went to fall more in love with Jesus. And one of the reasons that I have learned now of why the Lord sent me all the way to Virginia Beach from Ohio was because there was some unforgiveness in my life that God had to deal with severely. And I remember a time when I was on my knees and praying, and the Lord brought to very clear, vivid language that, Brian, you are in prison. And I could see this jail. I could sense it. The life that I was living, I was just torn up. And the diet that I was living was poison. And that's what unforgiveness does. Unforgiveness, you think you're getting back at the other person. You think that you're going to get revenge. But what's actually happening is you are locking yourself in a prison, and your daily habitual food and intake is poison. And the Lord had sent me all the way to Virginia Beach. Yes, earned my ending. Praise the Lord. But there was unforgiveness. Close people that I had trusted, even a pastor, had hurt me at the deepest level, where I turned my back on the church. And I said, never again will you see me set foot for the doors of the church. Unforgiveness. Hatred. Until God showed me, there's your future. Is that what you want? All I could say was, Lord, I'm unworthy. Lord, I am unworthy. And here's what I learned. When I look back, that was a defining moment in my life, not to get a degree, but to be unshackled from the prison of poison that would have kept me back from walking into the fullness of God's call on my life as an under-shepherd to the chief shepherd. Do you realize today that you cannot forgive? Don't even try. Begin by saying, Lord, I am unworthy. I need your grace. Lord, I need your power. God, I need the same Holy Spirit that came to me in the waters of baptism that created my faith. Because you see, the world's going to come to you and say, hey, you didn't have enough faith. That's why your son or your daughter died. You didn't pray enough. You should have prayed more. I've even heard church people say this. No. It's not about the amount of faith. It's about the quality of faith. What does God do in the waters of baptism? He creates faith. And he sustains faith. He gives life. He gives forgiveness of sins. He brings salvation. What does God do at the table? He invites you into communion with the heavenly on earth so that you would know not only are your sins are forgiven, but that person who has harmed you, that person that you're trying to get back to, is not the one being affected, but you are the one in prison. When you come to the table, you are forgiven of your sins so that you can stand before that person who has harmed you. Say, you are forgiven. Forgiveness is not condoning. Forgiveness is walking in the way of Jesus. You call yourself a disciple of Christ? Walk in the pathway of forgiveness. Amen. Please stand as you are willing and able to continue our service. say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for planting the mustard seed of faith in us. Water it with your Holy Spirit. Make its roots delve deep into your holy word and sacraments, and cause that seed to blossom and come to fruition in your timing. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
We ask your protection, guidance, and blessing upon your church, making it steadfast in faith, courageous in witness, truthful in teaching and preaching, and gracious in service. Use it to lead many souls to Jesus. We especially pray for our own church, interim pastor, leadership council and staff, deacons and trustees, our bishop, Dan Salvo, in the NALC, and all people in the call to make disciples. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Touch the hearts of every person here today and those watching online. For those who are battling sickness or illness, sorrow and adversity, the abused and neglected, and for those suffering the aftermath of Hurricane Ivan, we lift them to you in prayer and name them before you now in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Grant that the leaders of all nations, especially our own, acknowledge you as their Lord and Master. Let them faithfully and diligently do the work entrusted to them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Most Holy Father, receive into your kingdom those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. Remind those they have left behind of the sure and certain promise of eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Now we share God's peace from the pulpit side to the lectern side.
The peace of the Lord be with you always, and also with you.
Chosen disciples. At this, the whole earth exults in boundless joy. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son. You reached out to heal the sick and the suffering. You preached good news to the poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. For in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ, he took bread and he blessed it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup and he blessed it. He gave it for all to drink, saying, "This is the new covenant of my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us now the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food. The body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Holy Father, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. And at this time, the ushers will come forward and lead you for Holy Communion. our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of a godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Again, a joy to worship with you. Just a reminder for Nicholas and Aaron, for the children's sermon, you guys can bring a friend next month. So that would be amazing. If you have grandchildren, have them come. We're just going to have a great time getting to know one another. Amen. So bring all the kids, and I can't wait to see them next month. Now receive the blessing and God's benediction over your life. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.